فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، we were at the ending of Surah Abasa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وجوه يومئذ مسفرة ضاحكة مستبشرة. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وجوه, some faces that day, يومئذ مسفرة, will be bright. A group of people's faces that day, it will be bright. They are laughing, ضاحكة مستبشرة, laughing, and they are going to be rejoicing at the good news that will be given to them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us that the people whose faces will be bright in the day of judgment, whose faces will glow. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in two different narrations, he told us who it is. The first group of people whose faces glow and their faces are bright are the people of wudu, the people who do wudu. They do the ablution, they will glow, their faces will glow from the wudu in which they did. As the Prophet ﷺ, he said, Inna ummati yud'auna yawm al-qiyamah, my people will be called the day of judgment, ghurran muhajjalina min athari al-wudu. They will be glowing from the places which they place, the places of their bodies where they place the water on. So they'll be glowing from their hands and their arms, and they will be glowing from their faces. The places which they put the water on, they will be glowing from it. Also, the people whose faces are going to glow are حَمَلَةُ سُنَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ, those who are carrying the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who memorized its wording and are also carrying its meaning with them. As the Prophet said, نَضَّرَ اللَّهُ امْرَأً, may Allah glow the face of a person, سَمِعَ مَقَالَتِي, he hears my statement, what I said, he heard it, فَوَعَاهَا, and then he holds it. The word فَوَعَاهَا is like he's a vessel. If you pour water in the cup, what does the cup do to the water? It holds the water. فَوَعَاهَا, and then what does he do? ثُمَّ أَدَّاهَا كَمَا سَمِعَهَا, and then he conveys it as he heard it. He passes that hadith that he heard, and he conveys it as he has heard it, and as it has come to him. So the people who are carrying the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are going to be from those whose faces are going to glow the day of judgment. ولذلك الإمام الخطيب البغدادي, he authored a book where he called it شرف أصحاب الحديث, the virtue and the honor of the people of hadith. And one of the virtues that he mentioned for the people of hadith is what? That their faces are going to glow the day of judgment. وجوهن, faces. The opposite are the people whose faces are going to be darkened and blackened, are the people who go against the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Abdullah ibn Abbas, when he came to the ayah, يَوْمَ تَبْيَضُّ وُجُوهُ وَتَسْوَدُّ وُجُوهُ, the day when faces are going to glow and brighten, and when there's the day of judgment where there's faces that are going to be darkened, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said that the people whose faces are going to be brightened and glowing are the people who are holding onto the sunnah, Ahlul Sunnah, the people who have made themselves the people of the sunnah, have related with the sunnah, they live by the sunnah, ilman wa amalan, in terms of knowledge and in terms of implementation, their faces are going to glow. And we just heard the hadith of the Prophet, نَضَّرَ اللَّهُ امْرَأً سَمِعَ مَقَالَتِي فَوَعَاهَا فَأَدَّاهَا ثُمَّ أَدَّاهَا كَمَا سَمِعَ, that the people of the sunnah's faces are going to glow. Abdullah ibn Abbas said, وَتَسْوَدُّ وُجُوهُ, and a group of faces are going to be darkened, he said, وُجُوهُ أَهْلِ الْبِدَعِ, the faces of the people of innovation. Those who, after the religion became complete, and the religion became finished, and all that was meant from you was to submit, after the verse came down, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ, today I have completed your religion for you, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي, and I have completed my blessing unto you, وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا, and I have made Islam your religion. Where they should have followed and submitted and not added anything onto the religion, they came and they added onto it. And ولذلك ابن مالك الإمام مالك رحمه الله ودري سي من ابتدع في الإسلام بدعة يراها حسنة فقد زعم أن محمد خان الرسالة. That anybody who comes and adds into the religion, he puts something into the deen that's not from it, he has claimed that the Prophet has deceived the religion. Why would that, how would that come into place? Because the Prophet ﷺ said in an authentic hadith narrated by Imam al-Tabarani, narrated in his Mu'jam, min hadith Abi Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that the Prophet ﷺ has said to us, there is no path, or there's nothing, ma min shay'in yuqarribukum ila al-jannah wa yuba'idukum min al-nar, that there is nothing that will bring you closer to Jannah and that will distance you from the hellfire, illa wa qad buyyina lakum, except that it was clarified to you. The Prophet is saying, there is not anything that will take you closer to Jannah, distance you and make you far from the hellfire, except I clarified it to you. So when you come centuries, decades, years after the Prophet, and then you say, this is a good deed, and we look, we don't find it in the Sunnah of the Prophet, then what are you saying here? You're saying one of two. Either you're saying that the Prophet was ignorant, he didn't know this good that I have now come across, or you're saying that the Prophet knew it and he deliberately chose to deceive the Ummah by hiding it and not telling the people about it. It could only be one of the two. Then Imam Malik said a powerful statement. He said, لَأَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يَقُولُ الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمْ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا فَمَا لَمْ يَكُنْ يَوْمَئِذٍ دِينًا فَلَا يَكُونُ الْيَوْمَ دِينًا. What was not a religion that day when the ayah الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ came down, what was not a religion that day is not going to turn out randomly to be a religion today. What wasn't a religion the day of Arafah when this ayah came down and the Prophet read it in Yom Arafah? When whatever wasn't a religion that day will not be a religion today. Meaning it will not be something that will get you closer to who? Allah. And it's not going to be something that's going to distance you from the hellfire. So we have to know that if we want our faces to glow, and if we want to be people who receive this virtue of being from those who Allah said about them, وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ مُسْفِرَةٌ, then كُنْ مُتَّبِعًا, then be a follower. وَلَا تَكُنْ مُبْتَدِعًا, be a follower and do not be a innovator. ولذلك the Salaf, they used to say, it is more beloved and is more greater that you are a follower in evil, I mean, you are a follower in good than a leader in evil. You with me, brothers? It's better to be a follower. To follow and to submit and to be a slave and let your master tell you what he likes and what he hates. Don't make it up as you go along. And you're not going to know what Allah loves and what Allah hates and what pleases him, except on the tongue of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. May Allah make us from those whose faces glow the day of judgment. وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ مُسْفِرَةٌ, that day faces are going to glow. ضَاحِكَةٌ, those people are going to rejoice. They're going to be laughing. مُسْتَبْشِرَةٌ, they're going to be laughing and they're going to be rejoicing. Good news has come to them. What is the news that has come to them? The news that has come to them is that they are from the Fariqul Jannah. They are the people of Jannah. And I, subhanAllah, remember the day I passed my driver's license. I got it. The driver, I passed, he told me. I mean, I knew I was going to pass. The way I was driving and the way I went turns and everything. But then when he told me, I became so happy. Sah? Those of you who've passed know. But then, wallahi, what came to my mind is the day you get told you passed your test, the day of judgment. What is the news greater than that? Sah? It hit me that moment. So to be told that today you have passed your test, you are now from the inhabitants of Jannah. You're the people of Jannah. Ya ikhwa, this news will make you laugh. It will make you rejoice yourself. You've been saved from something that many are going to be destroyed in it. This is the best news you can be given. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us the group, the second party of people. He says, وَوُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ, and other faces, يَوْمَئِذٍ عَلَيْهَا غَبَرَةٌ, on their faces there will be dust. Their faces, غَبَرَةٌ means what? Dust will be on their faces. How would there be dust on their faces? Meaning, قَدْ تَغَيَّرَتْ لَوْنُهُمْ, their facial color has changed. The complexion is gone. It's different color now. It looks dusty because of the fact that it's not the original complexion that they were. Their face has now become a different color. The shock has taken away from them the color of their skin. They are baffled, lost of words. They've been informed now that they are from the people of the hellfire. Allah then says, "Tarhaquha qatara." Blackness will cover them. Then Allah says, "Ulaika humul kafaratul fajara." Who are those people? Those are the disbelievers, and they are the wicked ones. They are the disbelievers who've disbelieved in Allah. They've been disbelieved in this meeting, and that they're going to be standing in front of Allah and they're going to be questioned. They've also disbelieved in the message that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. These are the people, and the wicked Muslims who also went against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's way, and the way that the Prophet sent, also they have a portion of this. Also they have a portion of this. Surah Al-Takwir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. إذا الشمس كورت وإذا النجوم كدرت وإذا الجبال سيرت وإذا العشار عطلت وإذا الوحوش حشرت وإذا البحار سجرت وإذا النفوس زوجت وإذا النفوس زوجت وإذا الموءودة سئلت بأي ذنب قتلت وإذا الصحف نشرت وإذا السماء كشطت وإذا الجحيم سعرت وإذا الجنة أزلفت علمت نفس ما أحضرت فلا أقسم بالخنس الجوار الكنس والليل إذا عسعس والصبح إذا تنفس إنه لقول رسول كريم ذي قوة عند ذي العرش مكين مطاع ثم أمين وما صاحبكم بمجنون ولقد رآه بالأفق المبين وما هو على الغيب بضنين وما هو بقول شيطان الرجيم فأين تذهبون إن هو إلا ذكر للعالمين لمن شاء منكم أن يستقيم وما تشاءون إلا أن يشاء الله رب العالمين. Surah Al-Takwir, the overthrowing. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in a hadith, Al-Imam Al-Tirmidhi narrated in his Sunan, that the Prophet said, "Man sarrahu an yanzura ila yawm al-qiyamah," anyone who wants to look at the Day of Judgment, ka'annahu ra'ya ayn, anyone who wants to see the Day of Judgment, is like he's looking at the Day of Judgment, is like he's visualizing the Day of Judgment, is like the Day of Judgment has been placed in front of him. فليقرأ, he should read. إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ وَإِذَا السَّمَاءُ فَطَرَتْ وَإِذَا السَّمَاءُ شَقَّتْ. Read those three surahs. If you want to see the Day of Judgment and the matters related to the Day of Judgment and the affairs of the Day of Judgment and the people of the Day of Judgment and the situations that are going to take place of the Day of Judgment, the Prophet said, فَلْيَقْرَأْ, let that person read. إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ, And let them also read, إِذَا السَّمَاءُ فَطَرَتْ. And let them also read, إِذَا السَّمَاءُ شَقَّتْ. These three surahs, what they give you is a very powerful insight pertaining to what? The Day of Judgment. Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he said regarding this surah, أَنَّ الْآيَاتِ السِّتَّةِ الْأُولَى. The six first verses. This surah, the first six verses, it talks about and it deals في آخر الزمان, before the hour strikes and the day of judgment comes, matters pertaining to the sign of the occurrence of the hour. The alamat and the signs of the hour. The first six verses that we're going to take now in this surah, Surah Al-Takwir, is pertaining to what? It is talking about and is going to deal with في آخر الزمان, before the hour strikes, the alamat and the signs that occur. والناس ينظرون إليها, and the people are going to be looking at these signs. They're going to see it. They're going to be seeing it. والستة الأخيرة, and the six that are after it are going to be about في يوم القيامة. It's going to be talking about the day of judgment itself and the things that are going to be happening the day of judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, the first verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ, when the sun is wrapped up. The mufassirin, the people of tafsir, they differed and they have their difference of opinion regarding what is meant by التكوير. كُوِّرَتْ, that's being used in this verse. What does it actually mean? There are three views regarding it. The first view is إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ means إِذَا الشَّمْسُ, when the sun, ذَهَبَتْ, it goes. When the sun goes, it fully goes. There's no longer a sun anymore. This view is attributed to Abdullah ibn Abbas. And it is also attributed to Dhahak. And it's also attributed to Mujahid ibn Jabrin. And also Sa'id ibn Jubayr. These four imams, they said when the sun goes. Abdullah ibn Abbas, Dhahak ibn Muzahim, Mujahid ibn Jabrin, Sa'id ibn Jubayr. These four, they said it means the sun will go fully. The second view is ذَهَبَ ضَوْءُهَا, the light and the shining of the sun will go. The sun will be there, but it will no longer be bright anymore. It will lose the heat that it produces and the ray that comes out of it. This view is attributed to Ubay ibn Ka'b, Qatada ibn Da'amat al-Sadusi. Abdullah ibn Abbas also said this view. Those three imams, they said it. The third one is إِذَا رُمِيَ بِهَا, when the sun is thrown. When the sun is thrown and it's moved from its position and it's thrown away. This view is attributed to Al-Rabi' ibn Khuthaym. And Al-Rabi' ibn Khuthaym is a name that we've probably not come across now. Al-Rabi' ibn Khuthaym is the man who Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said to him, لَوْ رَآكَ أَصْحَابُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ, أَمَا لَوْ رَآكَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, if the Messenger of Allah was to see you, he would have been fascinated with you. أَمَا, he would have loved you. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said to Al-Rabi' ibn Khuthaym that if the Prophet of Allah was to see you, he would have loved you. And whenever Abdullah ibn Mas'ud would see Al-Rabi' ibn Khuthaym, he would recite the ayah, وَبَشِّرِ الْمُخْبِتِينَ, give glad tidings to those who are humble. He used to say Al-Rabi' ibn Khuthaym is from those. He would recite that verse and he would read it referring to him. He said the third view that I mentioned. But each view does not contradict the other. They do not contradict it. Because the sun will go from its place. And once it does go, the brightness will be gone. And if it's been moved from its place, then it's been what? Thrown. So all of those meanings are in the word إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ. So these ma'ani and these meanings necessitate one another, and they are all in line with what the verse is trying to portray. Allah then says, وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ انْكَدَرَتْ, and when the stars fall, despairing and vanishing. وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ When the stars انكدرت. The Mufassirin, the word انكدار, they gave two meanings to it. The first one they said is تَنَاثَرَت. تَنَاثَرَت means it scatters and it disperses. The stars just disperse. Like, you know, when a woman's necklace is out of, and it rips open, what happens to the pebbles or whatever were in there? The pearls and the jewels that are in there, they tanatharat, you say. That's one. And that view is referred to back to and is attributed to Al-Rabi' ibn Khuthaymin and Mujahid and Qatada and Ibn Zayd. Those four are the ones who said it. The second view is وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ كَدَرَتْ means تَغَيَّرَتْ. The stars will change. The color of the stars will change. And this view is attributed to Abdullah ibn Abbas رضي الله تعالى عنه. This view is attributed to him. But these two views, لَيْسَ بَيْنَهُمَا تَضَادْ. Between these two views, again, there's no contradiction. And the first and the second necessitate one another. And they go together, hand in hand. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentioned both of those for the Qur'an, in the Qur'an. For Surah Al-Infitar, Allah says, وَإِذَا الْكَوَاكِبُ انْتَثَرَتْ. When the stars disperse. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, فَإِذَا النُّجُومُ طُمِسَتْ. طُمِسَتْ أي تَغَيَّرَتْ. The light of it goes. So both of them are present in the Qur'an. And the language, it holds both meanings. In كَدَرَتْ, both of those meanings are in the Arabic language. They use it, أي تَغَيَّرَتْ أو تَنَاثَرَتْ. They use the word in كَدَرَتْ for it. وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ When the stars in كَدَرَتْ, it falls and disperses. وَإِذَا الْجِبَالُ And when the mountains سُيِّرَتْ are removed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to be doing all of this and the creation are going to see it happen. The stars in the sky, what's going to happen is going to what? They're going to disperse and stars are going to fall from the sky. The mountain that you see that are pegged on this earth right now are also going to be taken from the earth. And guess what's going to happen? The mountains are going to be crushed. And when the mountains get crushed, they lose its weight and the heaviness that the mountain had. So the mountain becomes like the cloud. That's what Allah means. وَإِذَا الْجِبَالُ سُيِّرَتْ The mountain will be flying over the people like clouds. These big mountains that no one can seem to push now. And in countries like Saudi Arabia and other countries which are countries which have many mountains, when they want to build areas or cities and there's a mountain, it takes them years to get rid of that mountain or to destroy part of the mountain. It takes them years. That mountain will be pegged off, it will be taken off the earth and it will be crushed. And once it gets crushed, it will become very light and then it will then be removed, and then it will be flying into the sky. That's why Allah said in another ayah, وَسُيِّرَتِ الْجِبَالُ فَكَانَتْ سَرَابًا It will be the moving of the mountains. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَإِذَا الْعِشَارُ عُطِّلَتْ وَإِذَا الْعِشَارُ And when the full term she-camels are neglected, the word al-ushar, the word وَإِذَا الْعِشَارُ comes from the word, the root word al-ushara. And al-ushara means the she-camel when it is upon its ninth month of pregnancy. And the Arabs, when the she-camel is tenth month, when the she-camel is pregnant at its tenth month, the Arabs, they don't neglect it. Because right now the time is close, they're consistently observing it, they make sure they protect it from any other camel coming into contact with it or anything being done to it. They take extra care about it. But that day, the she-camel that's 10 months, no one will be giving it any consideration. It will be neglected and it will be forgotten. Why would it be forgotten? The reason is because قَدْ أَهْمَلَهَا أَهْلُهَا وَتَرَكُوهَا مِنْ هَوْلِ الْمَوْقِفِ That day, the positioning and the reality has made everyone forget what's around them. That she camel that the Arabs would give that importance to will become something neglected. No one will give it consideration. Why? Because the stars have fallen. The moon, the mountains that were on the earth, that were stuck on the earth, are no longer on the earth anymore. People are shocked. وَلِذَٰلِكَ the jinn will also come out. And the animals and everything, everyone is shocked. And the jinns will say that day, we will go towards the sea to see what's happening. We need to find out what's taking place. The jinns will say that. Allah then says, وَإِذَا الْوُحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ And when the wild beasts are gathered. Some of the Mufassireen, they said, وَإِذَا الْوُحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ And when the wild beasts, حُشِرَتْ They said that the word حُشِرَتْ It means, some of the Mufassireen like Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu ta'ala anhu, min tariqati Abi Aliya, that Ubay ibn Ka'b said that the wild beasts will be mixed with the humans and the jinn. Even the lion and the wild animals, that they won't eat human beings. They're shocked what's happening. They will be together. They will be mixed with one another. The lions and the animals that we would run away from, we're not going to run away from them that day. People will not run away from a lion. And the lion will not even think about eating the people. Because of what? Because of the min hawli al-mawqif, the day and the situation pertaining to it is something that has taken the minds of everyone, animals and the humans. That's one qawl that mentions وَإِذَا الْوُحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ أي اختلطت. Ubay ibn Ka'b said that بِسَنَدٍ صَحِيح. The second view is a view attributed to Ibn Abbas and Al-Rabi' ibn Khuthaym, which is that it means death occurs. وَإِذَا الْوُحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ أي الموت. That view is attributed to Ibn Abbas, as I said, and Al-Rabi' ibn Khuthaymin. The third view is attributed to Qatadat ibn Da'amah, al-Sadusi, and it means, he said that it means وَإِذَا الْوُحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ أَيْ جُمِعَتْ that the people are brought together, gathered. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, rahimahullah, he strengthened the opinion of Qatada, and he added on with the qawl of Ibn Abbas. He said, these two are strong. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, he strengthened the opinion held by Ibn Abbas, which is death, and the view held by Ibn Abbas and al-Rabi' ibn Khuthaym, their view, and the view of Qatada, he strengthened that. And he dismissed the view of Ubay ibn Ka'b, radiallahu ta'ala, anhu. So he dismissed it. But all of those views don't contradict one another. He can't take those meanings. That when people are gathered, they are what? They're mixed. So the word al-jam'u does not dismiss the meaning of ikhtilat, mixing between things. And this makes the meaning more powerful when we think about that the wild beasts, the animals, are going to be gathered in front of us, and so in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all together, and no one is scared of the other, and no one is looking at the other. Then Allah says, وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ سُجِّرَتْ And when the sea are filled with flame. The Mufassirin, they differed in regards to what is meant وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ سُجِّرَتْ سُجِّرَتْ What does سُجِّرَتْ mean? There are two qawls what is meant by سُجِّرَتْ. The first view is, it means سُجِّرَتْ means أُشْعِلَتْ وَأُوْقِدَتْ That it's lit and it's flaming. That view is attributed to six of the great a'imma, such as Ubay ibn Ka'b and Abdullah ibn Abbas and Ibn Zayd and Shubrum and Sufyan al-Thawri and Ali ibn Abi Talib. Rather, Ali ibn Abi Talib, he said to a Jewish man, Ali ibn Abi Talib said to a Jew man, Aina Jahannam? Where is Jahannam? And the Jew man said, Fil Bahri, in the sea. And then Ali ibn Abi Talib then said, Ma urahu, you can read it like that. Ma arahu, I don't see him. That illa sadiqan, except he's telling the truth. This Jew man, I don't see his statement except the truth. Why? Because Allah said in the Quran, وَالْبَحْرُ الْمَسْجُورُ وَقَالَ تَعَالَى Allah also said, He said, وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ سُجِّرَتْ. So what do you see? That this the ocean is going to be what? Burning. It's going to be flame on it. The second goal is fadat, that the ocean will overflow. It will overflow, and it will increase in number, and it will overflow. That view is attributed to Al-Rabi' ibn Khuthaym rahimahullah ta'ala. He says, "A muliat," it becomes, and it there's two extra views that are mentioned. The third one is fujirat, that it sprouts. And that view is attributed to Al-Dhahak. He took it from Surah Al-Infitar when Allah says, وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ فُجِّرَتْ. And the fourth one is ذَهَبَ مَاؤُهَا, when the water goes. The ocean has no water anymore. This is attributed to Qatada and Al-Hasan Al-Basri. All of those meanings it carries. وَلِذَلِكَ the word سُجِّرَ فِي اللُّغَةِ, it takes three meanings. The first one is an imtila. When something becomes very full, you use the word سُجِّرَ. As-sajru, it means imtila, when something's full. So the ocean becomes full. And then iqad, it flames. And then it becomes yubus, it becomes dry after the burning. Because if water, something burns, after the flames go, it's no longer there anymore. The water will what? Condensation. The water will go fully and it will be dry. All of those three meanings are the marahil, the levels in which the verse goes through. The water goes through. This is the stage in which, so the waters is going to flood, it's going to overflow, so that all of the waters are going to become one. They're all going to mix together. Once it overfloods and they all mix together, then it will burn. Once it burns, the flame will go and there's no longer no water anymore. So there's no khilaf, because this in the Arabic language is called al-ishtirakul lughawi. The wording carries those meaning. It shares all of those meaning in the language. And if you really observe, my beloved brothers and sisters, the usage of this, it shows you that the i'jaz of the Quran and the miracle of the Quran, that Allah just chose one word that carries the marahil that the water would go through. Not having to say so much things. Just took one word, and for us to explain that it goes this stage and this stage and this stage, all of them is in the meaning of this word. This is the miracle and the power in the Quran.